This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book Fugue. Author Stephen Marlowe. Year 1951. Introduction. The Space Ark left its home planet, Earth, 2,000 years ago Canopus IV time, arriving here in the Canopus System some 500 years later. That is all we know for certain, the rest is mere conjecture. Two salient features of the Space Ark's unique social institutions stand out above the myth and fairy tale of our ancestors, however. The first is the fabled story of the Mutant-makers, and when one studies the conditions surrounding this phenomenon, the fabled story becomes cold scientific fact. On a giant balanced terrarium of a ship, which was largely automatic, seemingly isolated forever in the vastnesses of interstellar space, our ancestors lacked even a modicum of external challenge. They thus had to create their own artificial stimuli, or face an inevitable retreat down the ladder of decadence to barbarism. It appears that for a time they went too far. They created mutants. These in turn gave rise to a rigid caste system on the Ark, a system which afforded an extreme in internal challenges and responses. The second salient feature of the Space Ark's social institutions was its favoring of the Biola mental sciences over the Chemi physical sciences. This, again, proves to be an inevitable byproduct of the Space Ark's static environment. No physical world existed. Physics became a useless dogma, a meaningless jumble of terms which bore no semantic relation to the world at large. On the other hand, the Space Ark was a universe of introversion. The Biola mental sciences leapt ahead of what had developed into a something less than static civilization. This, as we have seen, gave rise to the mutant makers. But on a constructive level, it fostered the growth of a new science of psychology, vastly superior to the old Earth science, and, some suspect, considerably more refined than our own mental sciences. A particular manifestation of this lost science was the ability to project tri-dimensional images of dreams, to record them while the conscious mind slumbered, to play them back later and to interpret them unerringly. Andrews, Robit, A Short History of the Abortive Social Institutions of the Earth Canopus Space Ark, Introduction. Chapter 1. Kerjan awoke suddenly, sitting bolt upright in bed. It was cool, night period temperatures always were, but fine droplets of perspiration dotted Kerjan's forehead and dark sweat stains discolored the armpits of his sleeping robe. Over and over, one thought twisted through his mind. He was not a mutant, he was 100% normal Homo sapiens and a biotechnician on the hydroponics staff at that. Yet, why did he always dream the same dream of a big hairless Kerjan? His bald, shining dome topped with the three ridges of flesh which had manifested themselves in a series of mutations during the generation of his birth. Why did that dream always follow the same path? He chuckled in spite of himself. The psych technicians might yield the answer this time. He removed the electrodes from his temples, snapped the recorder off, rewound the dream tape. Yes, he'd let the psychotechs play with it in the morning, despite Clunian's warning. When the morning gong sounded, Kerjan crept softly from his room. His way would lead past the quarters of the female biotechnicians, and he hoped to avoid a meeting with Clunie Anne. But the slim, fair-haired maid knew of his appointment with the psych tech, and she had other ideas. Kerjan barely got past the portal to the female quarters when its door slid into the wall with a faintly audible hiss. Arms akimbo, Clunie Anne stood there facing him, the crown of her head hardly reaching his chin. "Good morning, Kerjan," she greeted him coolly. "Please, I'm busy." "I only wanted to see you for a moment, Kerjan. Just a moment, that's all. Will you take breakfast with me?" "No. I said I have an appointment." "You're always rushing around like the enzymes we feed into the ponic vats. I'm sure your appointment will keep. I'm also sure it is unwise, this appointment." Kerjan prayed silently that she wouldn't part her lips invitingly for a kiss, because then indeed, he might decide to forego his appointment with the psych tech. Apparently, that did not enter Clooney Ann's mind. She merely walked out into the corridor, hands still on hips, blocking his path. "Tomorrow we try to smash the mutant makers," she told him. "But today you must carry your dream with you, and have it interpreted. Won't it keep? If something lurks in that dream which holds the key to our plans, poof. No more plans. Stay Kurjan." Gently but firmly, he pushed her out of the way, smiled for a moment when she struggled futilely against the muscles of his good right arm. He said as he went on down the corridor, "We can take lunch together. I'll feel more like eating after this nightmare is explained anyway." The psych tech, Abnath Jog, wore an immaculate white smock over his scrawny frame, a pair of spectacles over his big watery eyes. Kurjan saw no reason for.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.